John. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends and family, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we remember the life of Thale Evan Harrison. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Let us pray. Oh God, you have ordered this wonderful world, and you know all things in earth and in heaven. Give us such faith that by day and by night, at all times and in all places, we may without fear commit ourselves and those dear to us to your never-failing love in this life and in the life to come. Amen. So one of his favorite songs was Amazing Grace, but he liked the modern version, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. So stand and let's sing it. Thank you. seated. Our scripture reading comes from the book of James, chapter 2, verses 14 through 17. It's entitled Faith and Deeds. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims they have faith but has no deeds? Can't such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Thale Evan Harrison was born on the family farm March 31st, 1931. Thale was the youngest of six kids. That's right, he was the baby of the family. When you own a farm, apparently you gotta have a lot of kids so that you can help work the farm, right? Isn't that the point? Thale's parents had, of course, cattle, pigs, chickens, horses, and they put him in charge of a lot of things even when he was very young. Apparently he was in charge of a team of eight horses at a young age, and also he had to help roof a barn at the young age of 6 years old. Put him to work early, right? Thale said, my parents worked us like slaves. We even had to raise radish seed, not just the radishes, the actual seed to sell, to, I'm assuming, to other people, so they could grow radish. Who knew? I didn't even know radish came from seed. I thought they were like potatoes. What do I know? They grow in the dirt. I don't know. So they had to do a lot of weeding, too. I guess they had a massive garden, and so they'd grab their buckets, their big, you know, 10-gallon buckets, and they would head down two rows that took them all day long to weed this garden. That's how big it was. Thale attended one-room schoolhouse on Ray Road. Did you know there was a one-room schoolhouse on Ray Road and M113 mm-hmm. in kindergarten? Then he went to Kingsley School from first grade on, and his cousin, Halsan, hey Halsan, she grabbed him by the hand, his little hand, and he carried, you know, led him around so that he got to know the new school. Thale was a pitcher on the Kingsley Stag baseball team in high school. And he was a very good pitcher. I don't know if you knew that or not. He never lost a game for one entire season. That's impressive. Bev met Thale in high school when she was in eighth grade. She said, well, I asked her, I said, did you notice his guns? And I don't mean the guns in his collection. I mean his guns. And she said, well, yeah. Muscles. Thale asked Bev to go to one of the games, and they began to date. After high school, Thale asked Bev to marry him. Well, actually, Bev said since she was the oldest in the family and Thale was the youngest in the family, and since she was used to giving orders and he was used to taking orders, she said, she probably said, well, it's probably time to get married. And he said, okay. The two were married by Reverend Emma Jean Quinn from the Kingsley United Methodist Church on May 8, 1949. The two lived in apparently in a little apartment above Pat Muth's house. Didn't know he had one there, so they got their own, but then they got their own home on Mack Avenue. And the family started to grow with the birth of their first, then Wanda. Then they moved to Manton around 1956, and Joni was born. Thale took an over-the-road truck driving job, and Manton apparently is where the headquarters of this business was, so that's where they moved. It was in 1967 that Bev and Thale bought the family farm, which he loved, as you all know. And the family moved one more time back to Kingsley. Bev said to him, I'm not gonna be alone trying to raise these kids and take care of the farm all by myself. So Thale, following orders, got a local trucking job at Cherry Growers and then Concrete Service, where he retired in 1993. Okay. Thale grew oats and hay, and he had a lot of local customers, but his passion, as you all know, was raising quarter horses and palominos, correct? Horses, he loved them. One of Thale's prized stallions was named Scottish Socks. That's a cool name, isn't it? Scottish Socks. And he had that horse for almost 25 years. Joni said that her dad taught her how to ride a horse. I asked, how did he teach you how to ride? Expecting, you know, some really drawn out lesson. And she said, well, he probably said, get on the horse, here's the reins, now ride. They loved to ride together down all the back roads, around their land, all their different property. It was great memories she made with her dad. One time, apparently, Gail and Wanda, when they were younger, they were arguing about the one bicycle that they had, apparently. And they were sitting at the table with their dad, and they kept arguing and arguing and arguing and arguing. Finally, Dale got up from the table, jumped in his trunk, an hour later he came back with another bike. So they had two bikes now to use. End of argument. When the girls started dating, Dale was always there to lend a helping hand. Wanda and Jim apparently went out on their first date, and Jim brought Wanda back in his fancy, loud sports car during a snowstorm. Apparently, sports cars don't do well in snowstorms. I mean, it was drifts. It was when you got snow back in 76, remember? 75. I mean, real snow. We don't get real snow now. That was real snow. But he still had a sports car. Jim didn't see the edge of the driveway, and he ran right into the snowdrift and got stuck. But luckily, Thale came out of the house and helped him dig out and then invited him to stay the night at the house. So Jim thought, this is great. I get to spend the night at my girlfriend's house. So the next time he went out with her, he decided he was going to get stuck on purpose in the snow. Spend the night once again. Well, Thale didn't help dig him out this time because apparently Joni said, my dad's policy was you get stuck once, I'll help you. You get stuck twice, you're on your own. But somehow it all worked out because Jim spent the night a couple more times. Thale loved all his son-in-laws very much. Apparently, the family joke is that if you break something at Thale's house, you have to marry one of his daughters. That was the joke. So, well, I believe it was Jim and John both busted one of these beautiful, there was many of these two beautiful globe lamps that Bev had, and they each busted one. So, they each had to marry one of the daughters. Well, you know, Dave went a little more expensive, and apparently he broke the front of a hay wagon. So, and he had to marry Joni. So, luckily, there was only three daughters. Did you know John and Thale were co-workers driving trucks together? That's the story. John said Thale's truck was always clean and meticulous. I know that's a shock, isn't it? Clean and meticulous. And apparently, inside in the engine, you know that place nobody ever looks, at least I don't, until something goes wrong, that was clean and beautiful as well. And the wheels on his truck were painted, you know, the white wheel walls were painted white. Thale invited John over to the house for supper one time after work, and that was when he met Gil. Thale loved his grandchildren and his great-grandchildren. He used to make them wooden rocking horses by hand. He even made grandson Brad a wooden candy cupboard. Apparently, Brad would run into the house of Grandma and Grandpa's house, and he would run right past Thale without even saying hello, and he'd head right to their candy cupboard. That's what he did. Make sense? Well, it didn't take long before Brad had his own candy cupboard filled with candy that Thale made for him. One time, Brad came over at Christmas time with his wife, and he ran out of gas. It's either snowstorms, ditches, or gas. People running out of gas. I don't know what it is, but it's the way it is. Now, it's Christmas, and there probably wasn't anything open. So they went out to the barn. Thale says, I'll fix you. And Brad said, he started sucking on this hose that was attached to the tractor. And I'm like, yeah, that's how you siphon gas. And he goes, and gas came out. And then he spit it all out, and pretty soon he got that car started and filled with gas, and off he went. Grandson Josh said he started helping his grandpa when he was about 11 years old on the farm. Thale would take Josh and show him how to use the baler for the hay at a young age, because heck, he was six and he was roofing, so might as well start him young, right? Thale even taught Josh a few new words when things broke down, apparently, on the farm. In fact, Josh said, man, could that man swear? But what goes on in the hayfield stays in the hayfield, right? Thale loved animals so much that when a small, mangy-looking dog showed up on their doorstep, apparently, Wanda said, God sent it, and I believe it, he took him in. He named the dog Mutt and would feed him special treats. One time, when I was attending, I had attended the Methodist church before, this church before I was the pastor, and I went out to shop at Northland. My girls were little, and I see Bev, and she's got, you know, chicken and fresh deli meat, and, you know, hers just looks so good, and mine was hot dogs, macaroni and cheese, you know, whatever we could afford at that time. And I said, hey, what are you cooking for dinner? She goes, oh, this stuff's not for us, it's for Mutt. The dog ate better than my children did. She goes, oh, yeah, I grill up the chicken, and we cut it up, and we give it to her, and fresh deli meat. I'm like, oh, my gosh, I'm coming to your house. As Thale got older, he realized he couldn't take care of the horses himself any longer. It took him a long time to realize it, but he did. Bev said it was the hardest thing he had to do was to get rid of his horses. But Thale never stopped farming. Oh, no. He was riding the loader up until age 87 years young, and raking hay up until 2019. Dale loved the family farm, and it was home to him. Dale also loved his church, this church. And most of the furniture you see around here at the Kingsville United Methodist Church was made by Thale Harrison and Joe Hooper. I've heard the stories before I talked to you about all what they built. Apparently, this church had pews facing this way at one time. And in order to accommodate more people, because the church was growing, they turned it this way. So they had to rip out these pews, and they had to, you know, this was not the same carpeting. And Joe Hooper was in a hole somewhere. I don't know. He's down in the basement of this place, which there's no basement, so I don't know where the man was at. But there's a picture of him in the basement and Thale handing him something. and Joe kept saying, yep, the floor's good. Now, Joe was an accountant, right? He was a money man. And so, you know, he's making sure that the floor looked good enough. And Thale said, no, it's crooked. And Joe's like, it's good enough. And he goes, it is crooked. It is not straight. We do not leave this place until this floor is straight. So as you can see, none of you are sitting higher than the other. So praise God that he had to make sure it was plumb and straight. So he built everything. He built the beautiful cupboards downstairs. He built this chancel area. This whole stage was not here. He built this, the railing, you know, the kneeling bench. He built, what else? Oh, the sound system back there. He remodeled Joanne's office, and he even helped remodel the parsonage. You know what? Thale even built those beautiful memorial boards that will now hold his name, and they are beautiful. You know, Thale was a faithful man. Did you know that? But some might say, you know, his faith was a little more private. I said, really? Really? I mean, maybe you wouldn't hear Thale tell the world that Jesus Christ was the Savior, even though he was. Instead, you'd watch him faithfully attend the church that he loved every Sunday, listening to God's word soothe his soul. You wouldn't hear Thale talk about God's compassion. Instead, you'd see him working well into the night, into the evening time, renovating God's house, because he loved God that much. No, you wouldn't hear Thale state the commandment of Christ to love your neighbor as yourself. No, instead, you'd see him dig these potential son-in-laws out of the snow, make sure grandsons had gas in their car, and to help anybody that he could when they were in trouble. So was Thale's faith really private? I don't think so. I think his faith in Jesus Christ was lived out for the world to see. Whether he was sharing the love of God he found at a young age with his grandchildren, one wooden rocking horse at a time, or caring for a lost dog that probably didn't have anywhere else to go, Thale lived out his faith in so many ways. James writes that faith without deeds is dead. Thale had faith in God. In fact, every night, Beth and Thale would pray together, and Beth would touch his chest and say, is Jesus still in your heart? And Thale would say, yes, he is. It's one thing to believe in God by faith, but it's totally another thing to serve God through the gifts he has given you. And if you don't understand that, talk to anybody that's a leader in a church, and they will say, what is it that you need? We need servants. Even the word says, the harvest is huge, but the workers are few. He was a worker for God. That was how he lived out his faith. He loved God inside. He wouldn't get up and preach. He'd say, give me a hammer, and I'll go build something. If you need something done, I'll get it done for you. If you need work on your house, I'll help you. If you need a loan for the hay until you can pay me next time, I'll do it. That was who he is. Thale wasn't working for his salvation, because we know it's a gift. We know it's a gift. He was serving God, who came into his heart and stayed there right up until the end. When Thale took his last breath on this side of eternity, Jesus carried him into his Father's house, where he is at home with his beloved horses, his family, and of course, mine. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift of faith that you gave to Thale. Because it is a gift. Salvation is a gift, but so is faith. We would not know you, Lord, unless you moved in our hearts to know you, and that's a gift. And we know that Thale took that gift, that love of you, and he served you well. May we learn that faith that is alive is faith that serves out of the love received by you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Grandson Josh is going to tell a story. And get ready, because I'm going to bring the mic out there, because I know there's a lot more stories than what I got here. So start thinking about those stories.
Hopefully I do okay with this. I'm not good at speaking, nor do I like to do that. So hopefully I get through this all right. So for those of you that know me, my name is Josh. My whole life I have been honored to introduce myself as Thale Harrison's grandson. And by that title alone, I was granted respect and trust. Our family would like to thank you for coming today to celebrate the life of my grandpa. In grandpa's words, grandma's going to have lunch ready, so if you can make it for lunch, we invite you to my grandma and grandpa's farm to eat afterwards, which if you didn't know was my grandpa's most favorite place in the whole world. The farm where my grandpa called home is a centennial farm where he was born, raised, and ultimately passed away. It was the best, well-kept farm, and to anyone who I described it to, where the farm was located, always stated the same thing. I know my grandpa took great pride in his faith, family, community, horses, his farming, and how straight he could make lawnmower rows. Nothing was ever out of place. I could find a 7/16 inch wrench at his house with my eyes closed. I don't know about you, but finding one at my house with my eyes open would take a half an hour. Besides it being one of my favorite places to relax and spend time with family, it was also a place where I learned to work and learn life skills that I use today. Just about all my memories of my grandpa came from the family farm. My earliest memory was simply my grandpa with all of his horses. Anyone that knew my grandpa knew how much he loved his horses and how well he took care of them. He had Palomino's quarter horses and multiple stallions at different times. Talking about a stallion, my grandpa would have been so mad at us. But anyone who has been to my grandpa's barn knows that there was a stall just for a stallion. I'm sure there's several of you there. Just guessing by the size of the stall, if you've been there, it's probably, 8x16 type of stall. So you need to picture that stall. I know this wasn't my idea. It's probably my sister's. It could have been Brad or Mike's or Dana or Sarah's, but you got a picture of this stallion in the stall, and then all of us kids standing outside of it. I was really, really small, and this thing was like a grizzly bear. The stallion was the mean horse, and then all the other horses were the nice horses. So the idea that someone came up with was to distract the stallion with some green while someone else jumped in the pen with it. Someone's job to distract the stallion, and someone had to jump in the stall, go run across the other side, touch the wall, come back, and then you were the winner. So I know I didn't do that, and I can't remember whose idea it was to do that, but I was definitely too scared to do it. Staying alive through the whole thing was quite the thing, and let alone, grandpa not seeing us, it would have been equally as scary if he would have seen us do that. And to my knowledge, to this day, grandpa has never known that we did that. So, when I was around 11 or 12 years old, is when I started helping my grandpa bale hay. Grandma probably offered me $20 to come over to the farm to help him. And anyone that's ever done hay, it would never go out and do anything in a hayfield for $20. But luckily for me, when I got out there, my grandpa threw me on the tractor and explained to me in a few minutes about how to drive it. For a 12-year-old kid to drive a tractor is one of the coolest things, and the $20 that I was now going to make became something that I would just have done for free, for just being able to drive the tractor. I remember, you're going to be hard to believe this, but I remember my grandpa drawing the gear pattern in the dust on the tractor. I know it's hard to believe that there was dust on the tractor, but just from beyond it creates dust. So he drew the gear pattern, and then he took his pocket knife and scraped away on the tractor to the throttle, just like it's how much fuel the tractor gets, kind of just getting a lawnmower. He took his pocket knife and scraped away some of the paint on the throttle to show me where to put the throttle to run the baler while he loaded up the hay. And to this day, 30 years later, I use the same tractor, and I position the same throttle lever on the same missing paint spot. It's still there today. So off we went, hay wagon by hay wagon. I got to drive the trailer or the tractor, and he loaded all the hay onto the wagons. As mentioned earlier, this is where I learned to properly talk to a piece of farm equipment when it breaks down. All I'm going to say is I'm glad Grandma was not out in the hayfield with us. Along with that, bale after bale went into the barn, which will be times I will never forget having with him. After loading hay into the barn, he would then ask me if I wanted to row the first two corns, or first two rows of corn, along the road. That way anyone driving by would not see any weeds in it. Anybody that knows where his farm is, this is a half mile long cornfield, so if you give it two rows, it's a mile long of corn. Then he would smile, and I would look at him, and even though to this day I still think he was serious, he would say, "Let's go inside because Grandma has a milkshake ready for us." He would always say that she's the best grandma, and she is. As the years went by, bale after bale, I went from helping him as a kid to him helping me as an adult. Up to about 2 years ago, he still insisted on driving the tractor and raking hay. He was someone who stayed active as long as he could, and someone that wanted to do just as much on the farm as he possibly could. Particular and stubborn, just ask my grandma. So be mindful of where you park when you come for lunch. Because we all know that he is watching. My grandpa was 89 when he passed away, and I am 41, which means he was alive 48 more years than I'm alive. In the 48 years I was not alive, we often sat inside the house or on the porch and talked about it. And no, you can't forget the lunch and milkshake from Grandma. We talked about him being a pitcher in baseball and how fun it would have been to have played on the same team together. We talked about getting Harley Davidsons, which is shocking to a lot of people, but we did. And we talked, I was always interested in what it was like to live through the Depression because he's so old, you know, it's kind of World War II, the Depression, had lots of questions for him. I know that I will greatly miss him along with so many people. I know that he has made it to the ultimate goal. I will miss him telling me that this is how a farmer would do it, instead of telling me I was doing something completely wrong. I will miss his guidance and asking him questions because I still feel like I really don't know what I'm doing. I could stand up here and talk more, but I know he'd want me to make it short. A few last things I want to share that he has taught me that I tell myself. Number one, be fair with people. He told me that everyone has hard times, and if you are fair with people, you will always make it. Number two, it's okay to take chances. I know he didn't mean to go out to do something crazy, but I know he meant with God anything is possible. Could be buying a house, a piece of property, or a piece of farm equipment. So right now I'm going to take a chance. Every time I've gone to a funeral, there has always been silence between order of events due to probably what is funeral etiquette. I'm going to ask that you fill this one with a standing ovation for my grandpa. Thank you.
Thank you, Josh. So now we're going to have an opportunity to share, and I know there's stories out there, and it's okay if it's a church. Don't matter. We want to hear some stories. But Bev says keep it clean. Wow. So who's got a story? I know there's got to be stories out here. Who's got a short story they want to share? I'll bring you the mic. You don't have to come up here. Anybody got one?
I'll go up there.
You'll go up there? Okay, come on, Sean. I'm just going to have a seat and drink my coffee because I'm sure this is going to be good.
Well, y'all know Theo. Theo is a smart man, and Theo is a lucky man. He married my sister. but one time, I don't know why I was going up to Bev and Theo's, but I was going to go up to Bev and Theo's and use it because I knew Bev had something to eat and coffee. But anyway, Theo had just come out of the driveway, and he had a tractor tire. He said, I'm going to Manton. Get the tractor tire fixed. You want to go with me? And I said, well, I really can't, Theo, but okay. So away he went, and I went and visited with Bev. Later that night, about 2 o'clock in the morning, with the Bev phone call came. It's Bev. Chummy said, Theo's not home from getting the tractor tire fixed. Would you come out and get me? So I went out and got Bev. Can you remember this, Bev? So anyways, I went out and got Bev, and we went the long way to Manton, and I checked wherever there was a ditch or anything. I'd pull off the road and make sure he wasn't down in there. She let out a scream. And so anyways, make a long story short, we went to Manton and checked around all his buddies' houses. So then we come back the back way across back to the bridge and everything. Bev said, no, if Thale's home, she says, I'm just going to thank the Lord and I'm not going to say anything. So we got home and there's Thale's pickup in the driveway. We walked in the house. He was getting ready to go to work. And he apologized. He met his buddy from Manton. But she didn't keep her mouth shut. I left. Another thing was, me and Theo, they had 2 barns there, and me and Theo down the barn, and we had Gail with us, and we were cutting sweet potatoes. And does anybody do that anymore, cut sweet potatoes? But we sat there by hours. Anyway, Gail was just a little tot. And me and Theo got talking and singing, cutting sweet potatoes, and all of a sudden we noticed Gail was gone. Gail was playing around, all of a sudden she's gone. And the barn floor had holes in it and everything, so we searched every place. We couldn't find Gail. So anyways, we said, we better jump the truck and we'll go up and get some help. So we went to help, and here's Gail. She had missed her pants. She's running down the road crying, Ma, Ma, Ma. So anyway, so that was the God thing. So then another time we went camping. Bevan, Thale, and me and Donna took their motor home. We went across straits. And we stopped in this restaurant to get something to eat. And anyway, Sale asked this West waitress, he said, could you tell me how to get, and I can't, he made up a fictitious name. And that poor waitress went every place on every table asking people how to get this taco. Anybody come to the door, the first thing he knew, run over and said, do you know how to get to this town? Well, she wanted a big tip, but she got a big tip. Josh was talking about the economy times, no hard money. Well, Thale said that when they were kids, the mother would buy them a new pair of jeans and then cut the pockets out so they had something to play with. Thale was my buddy, and he was everybody's buddy. Gonna miss him. And I'm like Josh, I put a plot of hay with him, and between loads, we sat on the elevator and talked about God and just everything, you know, and just was good. And then one load, Bev was gone someplace, and Thale said, you need to put up some hay, come out early. So I got out early, and he says, so it don't get so hot. So I got out there, and like I said, Bev was gone. He said, are you hungry? And I said, well, yeah, I could eat. He said, well, let's go to Buckley and get something to eat. So I went to Buckley and got something to eat, and they took me around where the tractor buried in the sand there. Anyways, so then we come back and Tom Heron was up in his driveway. So we stopped here, Tom got some chairs out, and then we got around putting up hay. It was pretty hot. But we had a good time, we always had a good time. I don't really like to repeat things, but Thale was always there when you need him.
Anybody else? You guys are so shy. Okay. All right, here comes Jim and then Julie.
Well, I'm the middle son-in-law, and I'm the guy from Chicago, where John is a farmer and a truck driver, as Thale, and Dave, he's a farmer and a truck driver, as Thale, and I'm the guy from the city. And I remember, you know how Thale always liked to look at scenery, and everything was beautiful to him. And I told him one day, I says, you know, I love it when I drive into Chicago on the Chicago Skyway and I see the skyscrapers. I get chills. And he just kind of looked at me. But you know, he didn't say a word. He just said, yeah, you know, when he drove truck, he went into Chicago, and he just agreed with me at that time. And I thought, afterwards, I thought, well, that was kind of cool. You know, he could have just put me down or said a whole bunch of different things. And then one other time, I got into woodworking about 20 years ago as a hobby, and I showed him a couple of my small projects, and he said, you know, woodworking is about 90% tools and 10% brains. Well, I thought he was saying that so that my wife, Wanda, would let me buy all the tools I wanted. But you know, I've been thinking about that. And I'm thinking, he thought I needed more tools.
So the first song we sang, Lord, You Come to Lakeshore, I knew that was their favorite song. And even on a regular Sunday when I lead worship and we would sing it, I would pretty much bawl through it. I just want to say, I made it through today. I was quite proud of myself. But anyway, just a real special thing is when every Sunday I'd be here, that's my spot for the last 20 years, and I would always forget to look up to see when this would happen, but at the very last song, I always saw them holding on the hands for the last song. And I never knew when it happened, if it happened in the middle of the song or if it happened before that, but I remembered to look up, and there they were, holding hands together. And so I hope that Rob and I can do that too. 70 years from now, so not 70, we've been married 30, 40 more years.
Are there other stories anybody else would like to share? Anybody else? I can come out to you. You don't have to come up here. No other stories? Anybody else? You can share them when we go out to the farm. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing another song. So I'm going to get the praise band up here, and we're going to sing Just a Closer Walk with Thee. So let's stand and sing that.
Thank you.
and give Fail back to God. Let us pray. Receive back into your arms, God, your child, Fail Evan Harrison, and grant that increasing in knowledge and love of you, he may go from strength to strength in service to your heavenly kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're going to end with one of his favorite songs, and Joe Hooper's favorite song, very appropriate, I'll Fly Away. Lord, we do thank you for Thayil's life and that he taught us that faith also includes service. It's out of that love he had for you deep down in his heart that he served. And so I thank you. I thank you for his lead and I thank you for his witness. Lord, we pray for the food. We thank you, Lord, for those that have prepared it. We ask you to bless it and bless the conversations as we continue to share memories of this wonderful man. In the name of Christ, amen. Thank you for coming.